So Heidi and I, at a certain point, saw that we were very interested in archetypal presences, unseen forces, and drawn to different literatures. And I'm a little bit more on the academic side, though I translate Tibetan mystical poetry just for sanity's sake. And I work culturally with material that's from the 9th century up to the present. And there's a very rich literature in what's called classical Tibetan that incorporates many of the traditions of Asia, both Chinese, indigenous Tibetan, and also India. And so I obsess, that may be the right term, on translation. What is lost? What is gained? And especially, how can the transformative force of what some of these texts were meant ritually to accomplish, can they occur in translation or not? So these are deep, deep themes that I think have all kinds of implications for those of you doing archetypal work. If you focus on text, esoterically we know in many traditions the world herself is a text. A very famous meditator on things Greek and Roman, Pierre Hadot, H-A-D-O-T, wrote a book on Isis. Some of you know Isis, a figure of, she stands for nature, kind of hidden. And he begins by saying, I've been thinking about nature, Isis, archetypally, for 40 years. And he begins to think about this. So the hidden dimension that really brings us to awe, wonder, consternation, and I think hopefully finally gratitude. The structure for what we thought we would do tonight is begin, if it's okay, with a ritual invocation that evokes a sense of rebalancing energies, invoking a sense of sacredness. It's a 100-syllable mantra called Vajrasattva. It's used very widely in many traditions. And it's a way of inviting one, almost like cranial sacral work, if that means anything, back into alignment with what I might call archetypal integrity. And so I would start with that, and then I would turn it over to Heidi, who will say something about the cultural and maybe historical context of the poem cycle, ritual cycle of text. We all have copies of that. And she will read it, and then we will see what speaks to us in the present. I will make comments or questions back and forth, and then at a certain point, she'll turn it over to me, and I will say something about the Tibetan tradition of smoke offering. So does that seem kind of okay? And so we're thinking we'll go for, I don't know, about an hour or so, and we'll take a break because it's going to be so exhausting, you know? and then we'll continue. As an image, we might imagine what unites, or at least in some conjunctio fashion, both of these is the image or the reality of a mountain. And Heidi, please help me remember that great phrase from Gaston Bachelard about mountains.
Oh, imaginal immensity.
Imaginal immensity. Imaginal immensity. We're both great fans of Bachelard, B-A-C-H-E-L-A-R-D. Sorry, it's the pedant teacher. Coupled with my bad pronunciation of French. So imaginal immensity, mountain. The texts that I will be presenting are smoke offering ritual that are done on mountains, imaginal and real. And Heidi Lynn can possibly say something about how mountains figure in her work. So does that sort of work? Any questions? emergency exits, bathrooms, coffee. If this were an all-day workshop and it was the afternoon, I'd suggest we take a nap and awake to chocolate, but this is a little bit different. So does that sort of work? Oh, yes, please. Thank you.
Is there a handout that...
Oh, yeah. So who doesn't have... Okay, so we ask that you share and you can take a look. Thank you. Okay. And, great.
No one has one. Oh,
yeah. What we are handing out is simply the text, which, to honor the tradition, shows the script. A representation of how it's pronounced, and also a translation. So.
Well, the Ugaritic won't have any pronunciation.
Oh, that's right. It's transliteration. I don't know how you would pronounce it, but there is some gentleman here who's been to that part of the world, right?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So much for mechanics. Any questions? You fasten your seatbelts. Okay. So,
I do have a question.
Oh yeah, great.
What's the relationship between the Tibetan ritual and the Ugaritic?
The Ugaritic.
Yeah.
Okay. Did everybody hear that question? What's the relationship between the Tibetan and the Ugaritic? André Breton's definition of surrealism is the chance meeting of an umbrella and a sewing machine on the table. Heidi Lin is very interested in Ugaritic, and then from something completely different, except for maybe imaginal immensity, I'm interested in Tibetan stuff, and for a couple of years we've been trading notes on it. There's zero as of yet, but that's literal and historical. Maybe we'll spawn some ideas for PhDs and things here. Okay. We know that Schillman discovered Troy by reading the Iliad, or at least that's what they say, right? You know the story? Okay, who doesn't know the story?
Okay,
well, this whole side doesn't know the story. Okay. So the Iliad, made up or not, Homer, that's my short version. And Schillman decided to use it in a divinatory way to see if he could find the mythical city of Troy, and he did. So who knows what you'll find? Okay, so it's maybe an inadequate response. I could have just said zero. Got connection. Anything else? Okay, cool. So before I do the Vajrasattva, in the fuller description on some flyer, thank you, Devin, so much, and thank you all the gods and goddesses who watch over OPUS and Pacifica, and I wish there were many more Pacificas, and the work that you're doing as a victim, perpetrator, or bystander in archetypal studies is just so valuable. And so my heart plea is that you continue to spread the news that stays news of whatever good happens here. And so this touches on the ethical dimension, which for me is important, of doing this arcane stuff. Who cares? So in the fuller version of the blurb, it says the following, and maybe it's another connection. Both Ugaritic and Tibetan visionary texts offer a rich field of exploration in archetypal studies, specifically for those interested in the alchemical practice of conjuring deities, living presences who carry the catalytic power to engender profound transformations. So as I do the 100-syllable Vajrasattva mantra, I'll do it 3 times because this is for our incarnational presence as embodied beings, our vocal capacity, and our conscious awareness, body, speech, and mind. And you can imagine that every obstacle, defect, every as yet unintegrated shadow bit is now being invited to the great cosmic dance of reintegration. And so then from that ritual context, I will then turn it over to Heidi. So I will do this three times.
Om Vajrasadu Samaya Maropaya Vajrasadu Deno Padentu Mabelwa Sutokayo Mabelwa Supokayo Mabelwa Ararako Mabelwa Sarasidi Mabriyasa Sarakarma Sutta Chichin Chirin Kuru Hum Ha 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 Ho Bhagwan Saratata Gacho Vajrami Nitsubhaja Bhavama Samaya Sato Om Vajrasadu Samaya Maropaya Vajrasadu Deno Padentu Mabelwa Sotokayo Mabelwa, Supokayo Mabelwa, Anorango Mabelwa, Sarasibi Nebiyasa Sarakarma Susame, Chichin Chirian Kuru Hum, Ha 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 Ho, Bhagavan, Saratata Gaja Vajra Mani, Sabajra Bahama, Samya Sato, Om Vajrasatu Samaya, Manopalaya, Vajrasato Deno Pa, Deda Deda Mabelwa, Sotokayo Mabelwa, Supokayo Mabelwa, Ararako Mabelwa, Sarasibi Nebiyasa, Sarakarma Susame, Chichin Chirian Kuru, Ha 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 Ho, Bhagavan, Saratala Gajra, Vajra Mamingsa, Vajra Pahama, Samya Sato.
Get into the text, yeah? So the text that I am bringing into conversation is about 3,000 years old, and it's from modern-day northwest Syria on the coast. Are any of you familiar with Ugaritic, the language, the history? Yes. And what's your name?
Rick.
For the rest of you, it's a cuneiform language that was one of the earliest alphabetic languages in the world in cuneiform, and it was, by alphabetic I mean A, B, C, D, E, 22 consonants, a little bit more for certain language parts of the language, but essentially it's one of our oldest accesses to that in cuneiform. And the culture of Ugarit, it was this area in northwest Syria that was one of the primal scribal centers of the ancient Near East. So it had relationships with Egypt, it had relationships in the Mediterranean, and so it has this really profound literature that we discovered that has brought a lot of different traditions and languages together, which is amazing. But the more amazing thing is that Ugarit itself, this kingdom, the scribal center, wasn't discovered in the modern times until 1929-ish. So we've had this 3,000 year gap between this culture and when we first started having access to it. So we've only really had 100 years of scholarship to get into this text. So that's just a caveat that anything I say is sort of fresh and like maybe not right, and we don't really know necessarily everything. And also Ugaritic is an extinct language, obviously, and it, in translation, that you have to use a lot of retroactive, weird, speculative practices using many other Semitic languages and languages from that area. Like, in order to be a real Ugaritic scholar, you probably have to know 5 other languages, and I don't know any of them. So for me, it's just, I have a heart connection to this text, and I have a heart connection to this time and place. And so that's a little bit about that background. And there's this text in particular is part of, they have this major epic cycle called the Baal cycle, and it's their, basically their Iliad and their epic poetry that talks about their pantheon of gods. And many of these gods get later talked about in the Hebrew Bible, so you might recognize some of the names if you're interested in that tradition. And the whole myths themselves are these amazing sets of poetry that describe, most people call them fertility, agricultural myths. I don't necessarily subscribe to that definition of what these myths are about, but they're like a lot of other myths we see later where they're dealing with nature and with the storms and problems of their agriculture, etc. And also largely about king succession, which a lot of these texts are about too. But this particular part that I've extracted is called the Cosmic Revelation Oracle or Formula by modern day scholars. And by that they mean it's a particular formula that's used throughout these poetic myths to have a god summon another god to come to them. So it's a text used to summon by a god to summon another god, and it's used very specifically and very rarely, but it's sort of a trope that is used to emphasize prophecy, divination, gods coming to other gods, like the actual words of god to god, which is a kind of unique situation. We don't always get access to like how gods decide to call one another to each other. We kind of hear how they interact with us, but we don't always get a glimpse into how they interact with each other. And in this particular use of it, the main god Baal, who is the kind of head of one of the heads of the pantheon, there's one slightly higher, El, but he is this massive storm god, and he is trying to build a temple on a mountain. This happens a lot. Gods like to build temples on mountains. And he is summoning his sister, wife, consort, twin. We don't really know. It's a sort of ambiguous relationship. And her name is Anat. And so Baal is asking Anat to come to his mountain. And the reason he's asking her to come is because right before this instance of this text, she's gone through this wild ritual slaughter where she's like done up herself and all this makeup. She puts on all this special material, and then she goes and cuts off all these heads like locusts everywhere, and cuts off all these hands like there's millions of bugs. They have these amazing descriptions. But what's interesting is she does this ritual slaughter outside right below the mountain, and then she goes in her own temple. She goes inside and does the slaughter again. I would say imaginally, but scholars often just say we don't really know. But there's an external slaughter, and then she goes inside and has an internal slaughter where she sets up all these chairs. She basically takes her captives and puts them on them, and then she kills them all again. And then she washes her hands in the blood, and then washes her hands in water. And she's sort of like in this slaughtery ritual days you often see these female deities get into, or they're said to do. And that's when these divine messengers, some might call them angels, some might call them minions of Baal, they come and they bow down to her, and then they say, we're going to deliver you this message from Baal, and now he wants you to come to the mountain. So it's sort of this invocation after a ritual, after a slaughter, to come do have this prophetic thing happen. So does that feel like enough context before I read the text? Okay, and we can talk more about and all the culture and the context, but I'm going to read the whole text through, and then I think Stephen and I can dive in to parts, or we can all dive into parts that seem to speak to us. Speak to renewable Anat. Deliver to the carrion dove of nations the message of powerful Baal, emanation of life force. Salt in the earth sacrifice, blood in the dust harmony. Pour peace for the liver of earth, still bliss for the glory of field. Tick tock tick, to my pink talisman, let's run quick. For I have a word to give to you. Matter, I deliver to you. A word of tree and a whisper of stone, moaning of heaven with earth, and of deep with stars. I understand bless bolts even the heavens do not know. A word unknown to humans, which masses on earth cannot comprehend. Come, I will reveal it to you in my mountain, holy Siphon, in the sanctuary, in the peak of my heritage, in the beautiful place, innermost inland of triumph. Is there a part you want to have me engage with first?
Or if you're moved to auto comment on your... This is Heidi Lynn's translation. I reminded of Ezra Pound's definition of poetry is news that stays news. Of course, maybe it's completely wrong, but I don't know what the archetype of error is. But there's something... Not but. There's something extremely compelling to me. Maybe the otherness of that, but it's not completely other. So I continue to be knocked out by it. And yeah, I have a couple of questions, if I might. So this was our idea, then we'll open up here. What the heck is a carrion dove of nations? Okay, I looked up in the Oxford English Dictionary and carrion dove isn't there. Oh, I know that carrion is dead animal meat, right? And a dove is just this bird of peace. I got all upset. What's a carrion dove of nations?
Okay, well, this whole beginning part is naming who the gods are that are being called and asked to be called, and calling them by two epithets. And Anat is being called by her kind of normal epithet at first, renewable. And so she can imagine she's a renewable source, a renewing resource, so she's a god of renewal. And then they call her by her kind of secret epithet. It's sort of like, hey, Heidi Gustafson, oh, hey, Hyde, like, if you have a nickname. It's sort of like the more secret, potent name. And delivered to the carrion dove of nations. The carrion dove is sort of the reverse or the inverse part of renewable, where every time you have renewal, you also have this dead sacrifice. So doves were used at this time for sacrificial purposes, and they were later continued to be used all along that area. But doves were used to be a sacrifice, and we also see that now in like regular wedding ceremonies where you just like set a dove free and it flies away. But in this case, it's like in order to enact renewal, you have to have this dead, liberated sacrifice. So a carrion dove is sort of the way to capture that term. And the word itself doesn't directly, it's not a literal translation, but it has the word dove in the Ugaritic. And in other translations, they sort of are saying it's the kind of like wanton widow of nations. Like she's this kind of gnarly woman who's just like not, who's kind of takes care of the people and is sort of freaky about them, but a carrion dove, I think, carries more of that sacrificial weight, and mm-hmm. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But, yeah.
Second thing, the line, poor peace.
Yeah.
For the liver of earth.
Yeah.
I don't think of the earth as having a liver, mm-hmm. but then all I know is that the liver as an organ, which exists in more than humans, seemed to be pretty important in the Middle East. And so can you say something about the liver and maybe the context of liver or earth, but liver in relationship to Anat? Because Baal's calling Anat, right?
Yeah. This whole section, this is my favorite passage, and it's also probably the most obtuse. It's a little bit hard to have access to, but these four lines, salt in the earth, blood in the dust, poor peace, still bliss, they were the first part that connected me to the text because of the ritual substances that are invoked. But the poor peace for the liver of earth, yeah, liver, if you don't know, in the ancient Near East was the main organ that when you would sacrifice animals, would be done, you'd have divination done on the liver, and they have these, we have records of liver models that they made where they would sculpt them, and they have they would have information, and they would also teach other diviners how to read livers based off of these models. And what it would tell you would be certain things, depending on what your sacrifice was, it would tell you whether the king should go forward with war, and if there was a certain line or a kind of coloration on a liver, or if it had a bulb in a certain place, and it would be like, oh no, you're gonna get hit by the storm god, or oh no, you're gonna you're gonna fall down if you try to do this activity. So livers were the main organ of divination. In this text, the word for liver is this, yes, the whole, yes, the word for liver.
Well, that word is pretty loaded with a lot of other meanings.
Exactly, the word is.
That's the line you said is gloria.
Is what?
You wrote gloria, the same word.
Yeah, exactly. So the word has.
It means heaviness, it also means glory, it also means liver.
It means liver, glory, heaviness. Also, sometimes they use it as womb or mind. It was basically the word that captured the inside of the insides, your diet. Like anything that was in here and you don't know about, a little mysterious, they've used it in that term. I mean, you might know more than I do, but.
But it's funny, especially in poetry.
Yeah.
When somebody used to say, with, I don't know if you said it, but if it doesn't mean at least two things, it's not poetry.
Exactly, yeah, and exactly. In this text, pretty much all these words, especially in this ritual section, and we can get into this more, they have multivalent meanings, and that sort of clues you in that you're in the presence of a god, when and or poetry, like when it has this multivalent sense of meaning, that means you can traverse kind of layers of existence like gods can or angels can, where you can come in and out, and you can experience things on a big picture or get really small and experience them in a little way or in a literal way or a metaphorical way. And so for the liver part, it's twice done here. It's repeated. The same word is repeated, and I translated two different versions of it in order to emphasize that in this case, it's trying to give peace to the inside of Earth, to the things that have been damaged, to the part of the Earth that has been processing all the crap that these wars have been happening. Like this is taking place in the midst of a war or a forthcoming war, and the liver is just, you know, when we war on our own bodies, it gets really messed up. And so trying to pour peace into it, this text into the liver is sort of trying to capture that visceral quality.
Mm-hmm. Doesn't the liver purify?
Mm-hmm. Is the liver purified in sacrifice?
No,
it's function.
It's function.
Yes, exactly. It's a purifying function.
What comes to my mind is purifying.
Yes, purifying. And when it's not working, then you get, or not able to purify, then you get a lot of disease, right? Or you get sick, or whatever. Yeah, you get very toxic. So, yeah, pouring peace is a form of purification. And interesting that it comes right after a knot.
That's what you said. That's what led me to speak up about.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. Thank you for that. Yeah.
I don't want to step all over that.
Yeah.
I'll shut up.
No, no, you.
The first line, VTLT.
Yes.
That means that's definitely virgin.
Right. Well, most scholars do. Yeah, he's referring to the first line where I've translated renewable a knot, and.
BLT.
BLT.
It's an Anat sandwich.
Yes, that sandwich. Yes, technically, we'll just mention briefly, most scholars translate it as virgin or maiden or sort of invoking a woman who has never had sex or hasn't had children yet. And there's not a lot of debate about this term. I chose to change it to renewable in order to emphasize the fact that in reading about this goddess and all these different things that she invokes, she's often used ritually for renewing purposes. And we often have this negative taste in our mouths about the words virgin, right? Because, I don't know, I think maybe not if you admire the Virgin Mary, which has a kind of a cool connotation, but the idea that, like, you have never given birth, you could have miraculous birth, your womb is ready to give birth over and over and over again. And for me, it was more focusing on the process that the word invoked rather than the actual physicality of the goddess. Just FYI. But yes, he's right. Virgin is the name.
Thank you. Okay.
Epithet. Yeah.
Two meanings.
What?
Two meanings.
Yes.
Then, for me, in there was a fair exchange about, I'd say, well, what does that mean? What does that mean? Well, the scholars say this, I'm going to do it this way, etc. The next two lines, one of which gloriously is translated by not being translated, that invokes a sort of kind of oracular obscurantism. So tick, tock, tick, and it almost looks like onomatopoeia. Can you actually pronounce the Ugaritic, sir?
Well, people just guess because it
well, go ahead and guess.
It's only with no vowels or in any Semitic language.
Yeah, like old Hebrew and stuff.
It's like Hebrew. So
yeah.
People usually vowel.
Can you humor us with an imaginal pronunciation? on the TikTok tip.
Yeah. My guess is it appears to be it would be like nouns probably, so maybe Keshek, Etsek, Betsek.
Yeah, that's pretty much what we thought, right?
That's it. So you can hear, even in the speculative pronunciation, you can hear this sort of mantra, tick, tick, tick. And for me, that's what I was hearing when I was translating it, which was tick, tock, tick. And this little section, you have the god calling the other god, and then you have this ritual invocation, whether we're purifying the earth and we're offering these substances, you have these ritual offerings. And then you have tick, tock, tick, which is just to invoke a sense of urgency to come to Baal. So it's just this part of this urgency. And I chose not to translate it's not my pink talisman, but there's a little bit of, always in these myths, there's that sexual undertone of when things are coming together, and you know, you're invoking a penis, you're invoking sexuality, you're invoking all these things. My pink talisman was just kind of cool for me to leave in as a sort of phallic representation of like, get over here quick, like, how long is this going to be here for? You know what I mean? So that was sort of why I did that.
Whoa. Are you saying that the Ugaritic that you pronounced as pink has some sort of English fleshy libidinal tumescent kind of aura about it?
That was my imaginal immensity having a presence.
We erased all the tapes of our interchanges about this. And that's not, it can't possibly be talisman. So is this, so.
In technical translation, it's basically to me, let your legs run, to me, let your feet race. So it's a double way of saying, just get your legs over here. But.
Okay.
It could be a third leg.
Oh yeah, and then it says, let's run quick. So these two lines are kind of saying the same thing with different words.
All three of those lines are basically just performing.
Oh, I see. Oh, so this is the performative. Oh, okay, cool.
Yes.
Wow.
We should maybe just do one or two more questions on this text.
That's okay. Yeah. Time is infinite.
That's.
Okay, so possibly my favorite translation, which is a stupid way to think about poetry, is in the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, both the word choice and the line itself. I understand bless bolts, even the heavens do not know. Could you say something about what a more retail, vanilla, prosaic translation for what you did as bless bolt is?
For sure.
And then maybe something about that line, and then that would be a kind of imaginary conclusion for right now in this text.
So in this section, this is the main section where Baal is telling you what the cosmic secret is going to be when you get to his mountain. A word of tree, a whisper of stone, blah, blah. Bless bolts, even the heavens do not know. And bless bolts isn't the technical term for this word. This word is often translated, it's the BRQ, as lightning. But it has this other term right in front of it, which it's a combined, basically I consider it a compound noun of stone. ABN is stone. And so it's really stone of light together, and they translate it as lightning, but it could also be translated as thunder head of lightning or stone head of lightning. And so if you imagine what you're thinking of is when you, if Baal is a storm god, you're thinking of both the sky, when you have thunder and lightning together, you're hearing the sound and seeing the light, and there's sort of this instantaneous of all of those things coming together. And so for me, it was more following what the god is doing. When he's on the mountain and saying, like, come here and see what I'm going to reveal to you, he's saying, like, I'm going to reveal to you this thing in my natural power of speech, which is this storm. The power of my speech is my lightning, my thunder, my bless bolts, these fertilization activities that lightning does. And they would have known that at the time also, not in the scientific way we do now, but lightning fertilizes the fields. It's also theorized to have been one of the catalysts of life in the first place. Under some conditions, they've done tests and said, oh, if you put lightning with a bunch of these gases, like, you get amino acids and there's life. But it's not, anyways. Bless bolts for me was a way of capturing what the god gives, what these natural powers give us. So that was part of that.
Wow.
Yes.
Thank you. And of course, we thought, oh, half hour for each, and of course we're up to an hour, but we're in a special time zone here. So. And now for something not completely different, but the piece that, and really all praise, I mean, Heidi Lynn, it's her poetic translation. I wimped out and used a translation by my colleagues of a text that is very well distributed through northern India, the Himalayas, Sikkim, Bhutan, Tibet. And this is from a revealer of secret treasures, which means, so it says, he didn't write this down, it came to him as a text. There's a revealed text, and there's a whole very powerful tradition, especially it says, for difficult times, many revealed texts that have been previously hidden, now is the time. I liken it a little bit to, and you'll know better than I do, there's certain species of trees whose seeds, whose procreative force only happens when there's a forest fire.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, what's the...
Isn't it just the pine trees? And the
maybe it's pines, okay.
Fire releases
so,
pine forest.
Thank you. And on the model of renewal, which is a thematic thing I never even thought of, connection, in difficult times there are revelations. And you can kind of read Latsun Namka Jigme, this is on page 3, was a 16th and 17th century savant who oriented his life to the arcana of the not yet revealed. And in Sikkim, which is a British name for a little part of the Himalayas, he opened up a whole heretofore unseen treasure trove that is called the life force of the Vidyadharas. So we use some Sanskrit there. So the life force of those who maintain dhara, highest awareness, vidya. So this is part of a cycle called the mountain smoke offering. So the mountain smoke offering has come from this great cycle. And this smoke offering is done on mountains, or the imaginal equivalent of mountains. And it is done for the purpose of rectifying, transforming defects, transgressions, failings, disharmonies, illnesses, both in their external sense of environmental disruption, in their internal sense of emotional and physical illness and upset, and in their secret aspects of blockage to final alchemical transformation. Now, we don't have much literature on that latter, so we could somehow, someday, maybe do something and look at Jung and other traditions about coniunctio oppositorum and alchemy and the great adventure of the creation or discovery of the philosopher's stone. But this secret aspect, rectifying secret transgressions, difficult. Inner transgressions, psychological, emotional, outer, environmental. And in the imaginal realities of these Himalayan people, and I'll say I had the privilege to study with such folks both here and in Asia for about the last 30 years. And we just saw a friend of mine yesterday who is a one who very much does these practices. There's not a strict, strong division between outer, inner, and secret obscurations. So this is a ritual, and I'll read it. And then if there's something that speaks to Heidi Lynch, she'll say, in which, in the presence of divine rebalancing forces, wisdom holders, there is the ritual invocation, which we might say is a depth psychological take from the Himalayas on confession. We acknowledge through the doing of this ritual, and we ritually apologize, but not in an egocentric way of mea culpa. It's more like anima mundi culpa, which sounds oxymoronic, but we can talk about that. Forgive, may intergalactic forces please rearrange things so there could be revivification. Okay, that's a lot of blah, 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 but you have some sense of that? Okay, all right. So, and in this, one imagines, we've put different images here, incense that is specifically made for this particular practice. Here's a stone carved by my friend, teacher, who we saw yesterday. It says, Om Mani Padme Hum, which is said to be the vibrational presence of compassion. And compassion is a technical term in Indian and Tibetan Buddhism. Doesn't mean, oh gosh, gee, I feel bad that you're messed up. Okay. But rather, I am in solidarity with all those who suffer. And it is my soulful connection to them, not my ego, hope, and fear connection, my soulful connection to them. And I vow to find the strength and resources to be with the weakest, those who ail the most, compassion. Some of you know the most famous incarnational presence, kind of in the West, of compassion is His Holiness the Dalai Lama. And he says, all living beings, not just humans, want one thing, to be loved and honored. They don't know how, that's the sadness. And that suffering in its most arcane form is the temporary inability to find ways to be with suffering and not be defeated. An example I will give you, and then we'll get to the text. Bill Moyers was once interviewing Marian Edelman. Marian Edelman started the Children's Defense Fund, African-American woman. Bill Moyers said to her, and this has to do with compassion, said, Marian, we've known each other for 30 years. It's like a triple threat. You're a woman, so how's one marginalized? You're African-American, and your chosen field is to work for those who are more denigrated than anyone, children. Okay. Of course, denigrated when they grow up, too. So with so many defeats, how do you keep going? She said, Bill, honey, you forget we're both Baptists? I never think about winning and losing. Every morning, I am renewed by the Holy Spirit to do what I've been called to do. So it's from that, it's a comparison I'm making, of the living force of being animated at a deep, we might say archetypal level, to not be defeated by the slings and arrows, by all of the terrible news, to try to find, without dismissing how terrible things are, a different angle in working with it. So this is a ritual that tries to do that. And the imagination is that one is doing this with the living presence of that force from which these revealed teachings came. And so I got some pictures of that being. His name in Tibet, in Sanskrit, is Padma, which is a word for lotus. Sambha, born from a lotus. So that's kind of not earthborn. It's kind of, you know, kind of unusual. And it said that he wasn't born normally, and he didn't die formally, and his energy is still available for transformational purposes, just like for those of you who are Catholics or remember having been a Catholic. The communion of saints, where you can actually pray to the living presence of people who are saints. So, so one imagines that this force which gave forth this practice, which is done widely, smoke offerings, and that what one does is one pours sacred substances that help rebalance outer, inner, and secret problems. And the fire is imagined as the renewable, vivacious presence of enlightened feminine energy. So I didn't even think of that as sort of a knot here. So when one pours it, then smoke goes. Okay. And I'll tell one little story, then I'll read it. The fellow Bakatuka Rinpoche, whom we saw yesterday, actually, he was doing a smoke ceremony this morning. I had the great privilege of doing them in many different circumstances with him. And we were doing it in the San Francisco Bay Area once, outside of somebody's house, a big hibachi. Okay, you could also do it on a mountain. We're doing this and all this stuff. And you know, his idea of a short ritual might be 5 hours. And your clothing is like, you can't even wash it. You need smoke offering cloth, you know, cloth, and then just burn it or something. And at one point, I look, and sliding glass doors, there's two firemen with their hats on.
I think this is a good story. And I'm reminded of this yesterday. And he pays no attention. He's been known to go for hours and just not even say anything, except ritually be chanting. Thing's over. He doesn't say anything for a long time, and he just turns to me and says, "Americans are so stupid. They don't know the difference between ordinary and sacred smoke." Yeah. Anyway, yeah. Okay. So, and it's good luck to actually pronounce the Tibetan. So the text says Rigzin Sotrup Lay, which is from the life force practice of the Yadaras, the Riwo Sancho, the smoke offering. And it begins with a seed mantra, that is to say, it's like the pine tree seed. It's like with this seed, it invokes a grounded sense of impending elemental rebalance. And so you can see it says, boom. You see that? Okay. And so we have this sense of the fire as the infinitely renewable presence of enlightened feminine energy, and it's being witnessed by the undying presence of the lotus-born one, and it's in that cauldron, in that vessel, which has very strong alchemical implications, that this practice is done. And I chose this because it names all of those internal and external forces that are making life difficult because we ourselves haven't found the key to alchemical transformation.
Okay.
All right. Drum, in the vast lustrous vessel made of the essence of various jewels, the Samaya substances, all the desirable objects in worldly existence are transformed into the nectar of wisdom through the blessing of the three seed syllables, Om Ahum. So that all that appears and exists becomes an offering of all that is desirable. This I offer now to the gurus, the yidams, the dakinis, the dharmapalas, and to all the mandalas of the Buddhas of the 10 directions, and to the local deities of this world, beings of the 6 realms, and guests to whom I owe karmic debts, and especially to those who would steal my life and deplete my life force, and also to the malicious Jungpo demons who inflict sickness and obstacles and bad signs and dreams and all types of evil omens, and to the 8 classes of negative spirits, the masters of magical illusions, and to those to whom I owe karmic debts of food and place and wealth, and to forces that bring obscuration and madness to the shades of men and women dead, to all the spirits, the Teirangs, the ghouls, and female ghosts. Now, all my karmic debts are paid. Now, burnt in the scarlet flames, whatever each one desires, may the objects of their desires rain down now, for as far and as long as space exists, I dedicate an inexhaustible amount of sensual stimulants. May my negative actions and my obscurations accumulated in the past and the present and into the future, and my misuse of offerings made to the Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha, the 3 jewels, and in devotion for the dead, may all such be purified in the fire of this smoke offering. Let its flames fill the entire universe, and every minute particle of flame becomes an inexhaustible cloud of offerings like that of Samantabhadra, the all good energy, pervading throughout all Buddha realms. May these flames, offering rays of 5 colored lights of wisdom, pervade throughout the 6 classes of beings, down to the lowest hells, the 3 realms of samsara. May they be liberated into the rainbow body of light, and may all sentient beings awaken into the heart of enlightenment. With Om, Ah, and Hum, this offering is made 100 times, 1,000 times, or several 100,000 times. Longer version might take 5 hours.
What's been hitting
me
this time?
I might be.
I'm actually curious about you were talking to Bhakta Tupu Rinpoche before or yesterday, mm-hmm. and you were asking him what you visualize when you read this text. Like, I know we have this. You have a fire, and you're seeing this smoke, and you're kind of doing this compassion practice of offering every single substance you could possibly imagine to the dead and to ghosts and ghouls, and you're giving everything that might be able to inflict obstacles upon you, everything they desire, so they no longer want to bother you.
Correct.
So what are you, but besides the fire and the smoke, is there, are you also imagining something else? Did he say that, or is it this, or
you
is that have, the...
Okay, yeah. So there's two things to imagine. The fire is, we might say, the alchemical vessel that is moving. And it is imaged as divine feminine presence, burning, accepting. Well, it's not saying, oh, I'm not going to burn that. I don't like it. It's an impure thing. Yeah. So you visualize that every bad thing you can think of, this is the alchemy of confession, is being accepted. You know, sometimes, I don't know how it works, but maybe there's some things that we can imagine we would confess that are too terrible, right? Are there inexorable sins? And this is a big deal in Christianity. In this, everything is accepted. So there's nothing, to use a Jungian reality of the shadow, there's nothing that is not accepted. And because I'm invoking Jung again, I want to make a crucial distinction, which I didn't know till James Hillman made the distinction. In his read of Jung, it's okay to talk about Jung here?
Yeah.
Right, just want to make sure. In his book, his long article on the anima, he said that he felt that Carl Jung used the word archetype in two conflated ways. One, archetype as an explanatory principle, and the other, archetype as a living, numinous presence. Okay. So, this is a ritual text that assumes that you went to finishing school and you know all that principle and stuff, but it has to do with invoking, believing, about the archetypal presence. And so the fire, when you say visualized, it's not just visual. It's chanted, so it's a bodily vibration. It's somatic, and there's also gestures maybe you've seen. And also there might be an eidetic or imaginal presence that has a visual component. And the texts are very clear that it's also beyond imagination. That's also beyond time. And they make a big point, which befuddles analytic philosophers and logicians, that this is a set time with a set liturgy that is meant to bring about a radical transformation into beyond time. Okay. And beyond concept and beyond limit. So there's no holding pattern of did I do it right or not. You are giving up, it's beyond hope and fear. You are putting everything into this fire. Everything is being burned, including your felt sense of shame. It's all being consumed. You know beforehand it's for a good purpose, okay? So that's the fire, and you're invoking as real culturally all of these hidden, secret, bad, hidden faults, all these ghosty things, and we're not doing a course on Himalayan demonology here. We don't have time. But these are seen to be living presences and malicious, but they're not intrinsically evil. The notion of intrinsic evil is really foreign to the Himalayan imagination. There's a deep sense that, as Pierre Trudeau, the father of the current minister of Canada, once said, the universe is no doubt unfolding as it should. Okay. That is to say, there are deep cosmic forces that are amenable to rebalancing. There are laws of nature. Doesn't mean that we like everything that's occurring, but if one has a larger frame, cognitively and ritually speaking, there's nothing, there is no situation, can't be worked with. And it's much better to find ways that are emotionally and mentally safe to work with deep trauma, deep hurt, not through some blurting out of confessions or accusations, but one imagines that the cosmos itself is a container within which, with appropriate safeguards, great transformation can occur. And it's a restoration. And so that one is encouraged to, through one's ritual sense, not be your normal self, be that source from which these texts came, or your ordinary self. And everything that occurs is the feminine form of complete transformation of what arises. I don't know if that was responsive.
Yeah.
I mean, these are big things I'm saying. It brings up all kinds of stuff. Anything else?
I mean, the other thing that strikes me, and then we might want to take a break, is that right?
Yeah.
And maybe this is interesting to some other people in the audience, but like, what is karmic debt?
Oh. So we have two words, karma and debt. Okay. So debt is something I've been obsessing about recently. There's a very good book by, I think, David Gruber, who talked about a history of debt, 5,000-year history of debt, or the invention of debt. I can't recommend it highly enough. Debt, in simple terms, arose out of a sense of human beings being interactional social beings in which we make agreements. Remember, there used to be barter. I have forks, I don't have any knives, you have knives, okay? And then I suddenly have a greater desire for knives than you do with forks. So you say, you can owe me, okay? And then it turns out that that debt that I owe you, and I agreed to it, can be transferred to my relatives. Anybody here ever hear of a term, student loan? Okay, so you know, no reason to read Charles Dickens anymore, but in England, there's something called a debtor's prison. Okay, and people worry a little bit about it. So as a professor, I feel kind of ethically conflicted about trying to do really good work that means something in my classes, knowing that we're just one remove from my students going to debtor prison. I'd be hyperbolic on purpose. Do you follow me on this?
Yeah.
And it's a, you know, okay, I'm gonna say it's an obscenity. And you know, the other obscenity is more and more student dollar goes for administrators and not teachers. But, you know, what to do. So that's the debt part. There was an agreement, okay, and we're on the cusp of not honoring it. So, you know, I'm going to be the country of Greece and you're the International Monetary Fund, and I'm going to go, well, I'm not going to pay you. And it's like, well, the world didn't end, but people were upset, right? I'm not suggesting you don't pay your student loans.
Do you mind saying the name of the author?
Great, I think it's Graeber, G-R-A-E-B-E-R. If you look up debt or history of debt, it's there.
Thank you.
And he's an anthropologist. Oh, the other thing is, maybe you know of, what was the other, the author who did Trickster Makes the World? Yeah, so he also wrote a book on gift. And if you've even slept through a course in anthropology, you know that gift means obligation, right? You know, my favorite story, I have some Jewish mother jokes. I can have them because my mother was not Jewish, my father was. You know, so the son is going over to his mother, the Jewish mother, for dinner. And so he wears one of the ties she gave him. So he goes over there and she says, so what's the matter with the other tie? So that, the cultural fixity of that is problematic perhaps. But the point is, oh, they gave me something. I guess I have to give them something. And that gifting is obligation. So I think that gift and debt are really related. karma, it comes from the Sanskrit root kur, which means something working. When there's an imbalance or a problem in the way that things work, karma, there are results. So it's called, there's nothing that doesn't have results with our human intention. This is what they say, okay? But when what's working goes well, the same root kur is not karma, it's karuna, which means compassion. It's like, you know, I feel you. You know, oh, so like, for instance, karma version would be, I know I owe you for those knives, that, you know, but I can't pay you right now, okay? And you're going, that's you, the debt look, okay? But then you might do something, as Bill Clinton made famous, you could say, you feel my pain. Okay, that would be the karuna part. So karma means that in the past, and it could have been like some time ago, all human beings at least do stuff that we're not completely in control of and we feel bad. You know, you heard this thing called the id? Okay. It's that sort of comic Freudian notion that gets complexified when we have notions of collective unconscious. But stuff pops up. You've read about that, right? We do stuff. And then we kind of feel bad about it, and we shine it on. And so the deep human thing here is that we exist in an interactional nexus with other beings, and we're always, hopefully this isn't too problematic, we're always not being 100% existentially aligned with highest purpose. Okay? We're not talking about anybody in here, but it's possible. And so there might be a debt. It's like, oh, you know, I should have, you know, I should really pay you. Okay? But I'm not doing it. And so then you or your many generations later, your heirs get grumpy. And it's like, to use a Tibetan term, oy vey. Or as my grandfather used to say, huh. So there's all these forces out there, and this is not, I'm going to count every single one. You just go outer, inner, and secret. I'm sorry, but not me, Goodman, sorry. I'm ritually redoing this, because you don't want to reinforce an egoic hope and fear thing afterwards. So if it's a good thing, may all beings be happy. You have to, the alchemical, the alembic is really important, right? This is not scourging, okay? All right, so that's a little bit on it. Okay. On that cheery note, should we take a break?
Yes.
Okay, look. If anybody like me, yeah.
I always think of Kuan Yin as being, you know, Bodhisattva, compassion, that would be someone that they would turn to for this kind of blessing.
Yeah.
Do you know anything about the history of it, like why it isn't Kuan Yin?
Yeah. So, did you want me to say something about it, or you just want to know if I knew about it? So Guan Yin, anybody sleep through a course in Chinese? Guan Yin, in Japanese, Kanon, in Sanskrit, Avalokiteshvara, in Tibetan, Chenrezig, is regarded by those in the faith, we won't get geeky history, well, I'll get a little bit geeky historical in a second, the living presence of compassion. And remember what we said in these traditions, compassion is not gosh-gee, I feel bad that you're messed up, but rather the almost like warrior goddess presence of being able to be with those who are in great suffering without collapsing.
Yeah.
Okay. So iconographically, the word Avalokiteshvara is Abba, you're bending toward, I'll get to Guan Yin in a second, You're bending toward beings who are suffering, and you're looking at them with regard, okay? Okay. Also, the Tibetan Chenrezig is, again, you're looking. So it privileges the, like the heart through the eyes, you're regarding them. You know, you have high regard for someone. For some reason, when Buddhism came out of India and went into China and stuff, and they knew this imagery and stuff, but they took like a kind of different reading, and rather than say bending or looking toward, it's bending and listening to. Mm-hmm. So Guan Yin means listening to the cries of the world. Mm-hmm. There's just the, you know, okay. And also Kanon, K-A-N-N-O-N. The other thing that seems to have changed is in India and Tibet, many of the forms or images kind of male. A little bit, you know, gender bending depending on who's doing the sculpture. But quite often in Chinese and Japanese, Guanyin Kanon is imaged as female. It's like, well, what is it? Well, one of the things you learn is you can gender bend. That's you're talking about trolls and stuff. You can appear in ways that don't freak out beings who are already freaked out. Okay, this is it's a mitzvah, which is a technical Tibetan term. It means you're trying to do a good deed. Yeah. You know? Okay, and so the main thing is not to freak out a possible patient. Including not presenting yourself as a doctor or a healer that can like fix everything. Best film on this? Ellen Burstyn in what was the name of that film? Not Redemption, something like that. I can't recommend this highly enough. She got paralyzed She got paralyzed in an auto accident, and as part of her recovery, she came into the gift of being able to heal. She gets shipped back home to Bible Belt, and at a certain point, people are saying, you have to invoke Jesus, because if you don't, you're doing the work of the devil. And so it's an ethical crisis for her, and she leaves that as much as she loves it. And the next thing we see her is she's a kind of a crotchety, kind of a crone type person now that gives gas in stations and right out. And then we see these people pulling up, and I get a chill just thinking of this. And the parents are going to the bathroom, and then a kid is there, and he's got no hair, and you totally get that he's got cancer. And she totally, because she's psychic and she has this kind of, and she just figures out a way to give him a healing. And then they go, and they have no, and the parents have no idea, they pay for the gas, and the kid, there's something about like how the, I'm still getting the chill, there's something about the kid kind of acknowledges this thing, and you get that he's resigned, he knows he's going to die, or at least that's what his parents are saying. And it's like, WTF, you know? And that's a technical term. And but then like something changes a little bit. So male or female, that was the jumping off part. You don't want to freak people out who are already freaked out. So it can come in many different ways. This, in a way, is the meeting of earth and sky, which is also imaginal immensity. Because if you think of it, a mountain is related to the core of the earth, isn't it? And we have one vivid example of volcanoes, mm-hmm. and then goes all the way up to the sky. So this is a special rock here, earth, and then these letters, sound, ruach, vach, pneuma, prana, up there. So this is considered a healing stone. So I blew it by telling you. See, this was just like beyond the download. So I don't know if that is just wildly non-responsive.
Well, you were explaining, I was curious why she wasn't invoked instead of this.
Well, first of all, okay, this is Tibetan, yes. So when in Rome,
yeah.
You know, so in one of the forms, one of the forms of compassion that he's related to is Avalokiteshvara. You know Guan Yin, so you're sort of Sino-centric in your orientation. Fine. Tibetans aren't going to invoke a Chinese iconography, but it is compassion. And the compassion form, you can also see yourself as Avalokiteshvara. So that energy can do that. And I want to ritually do that. See, I'm ready for you. Got this, but look what's here. Right? See, the compassion is there. So you can. And these are not traditions that go, I said brown rice, not white rice, you know? Like in Monty Python, you ask your favorite color, you get it wrong, and you just smoke. That's not what's going on here. So I don't know, does that help?
Yeah.
And IMDb says the name of the movie is Resurrection.
Thank you. I highly recommend Resurrection. It's just... It's one of my favorite, you know, there should be mitzvah fest, like a whole bunch of films where people are doing good deeds, because we got schlump fest happening all the time, right? Well, who needs that? Yeah, please.
So I have a couple of questions. So this seems like a very powerful ritual, and the way it's written is more for the individual person with his sins and his inner, outer, and secret.
Because it says I.
Because it says I, but are they also doing it for the collective? Because it
yes.
seems like...
Yes.
Yeah.
All ritual is said... There's something that I didn't mention because, you know, who's got all day? George Carlin said we just don't have all day. Exactly what part of all day don't we have? I sort of miss him, George Carlin. you can also imagine all beings... And if you want to get really out there, all beings of the past, present, and future are likewise doing the practice. It sort of lowers the concern for malpractice suits.
Right.
You know, right. Hey, you know, he was there in the operating room.
So
yes, and the I, it's not you or Goodman doing it, even though I'm saying I am... Guan Yin or whatever, Padmasambhava. So it's my altered ego. Mm-hmm.
Your soul.
So you got some more.
So yeah, and then so it kind of reminds me of the jewel tree of Tibet, some of those kind of processes and sayings, and then also. So how important is it to do the smoke? A lot of the Tibetan rituals are imaginal, and they imagine every little aspect of everything. So is it necessary to have the smoke for all those sins to go into? And
What's the saying? These are all very good questions. Like I'm grading the questions. what's the phrase? This won't be so easy to look up. Everything that's not mandatory is optional, something like that. Because you don't want to be outed as some kind of ritual freak, and then people are going to have blowback, like, I'm here, I can help you. Jeez, you know. You do it on the down low. So there's, you know, sometimes Tibetans, they blow it and see what like this. With a point like this, like they have some kind of pretty controlled Tourette's or something. But like the stone yogis are just going like, well, maybe they're going like, you know. But the best is like, hey, you know, it's your round for buying beer and stuff, and you're like, who was that? You know. So stealth. So you adjust. There's a great Tibetan phrase. I'm sure you've heard it. Gamla Gangbul, which means. To each according to their capacity. So the most important aspect, I promise we're not going to fall into the pit of Buddhist depth psychology.
Okay.
But the greatest way of going beyond one's current limits so-called perfections is, number one place is the practice of generosity. And generosity means showing up genuinely with no agenda in the living presence of another human being. And if one does that, with, you know, you're not trying to get something out of them, let alone like heal them or like find out if they're going to sue you or, you know, whatever. Those, there's maybe more than different reasons to relate to people than those. But whatever, hope and fear are the terms. Just like dropping that and showing up, then what emerges is a more precise reading of their contours and their boundaries and their buttons, which is the energetic presence of ethics. Ethics in these traditions means going beyond your stereotyped judgment of what's really up for those people. Okay? But it starts with generosity, which allows you to assess in real time and not remember that 3,500 years ago they sat on you. Okay? And with that sense of tuning in to their concerns, you're getting off of your thing. And then a funny thing emerges out of that, which is a kind of patience. There's people are actually, according if you believe this, fascinating. They're fascinating, you know? And what gets in the way of really sharing in the delight of that fascination is our hope and fear, oh, they're this and we have those labels. So that tuning into their boundaries allows us to stick around a little bit longer than maybe we'd scheduled. That's called patience. We have generosity. We have generosity. Then we have a kind of ethical tuning into their boundaries. Then we have patience. We're sticking around. And then when we stick around, we find there's this amazing thing that happens. We had a schedule of meeting, it was, oh, we've got so much energy, they're going to be an energy drag, or we're going to get off on the meeting, and then later, you know, at the end of the day, okay? And so authentic energetic renewal happens automatically. We can find a way to genuinely align with what's present. So we've got the generosity, we've got the tuning in ethically, we have the patience sticking around, it's fascinating. And then all of a sudden, we have all this energy. So when we say, like Tibetan friends say, how can you be tired, dude? Like, you got born, we don't know how long you're going to be here, but this is like a friggin' miracle, you know? I don't want to hear about the labor pains, show me the baby. That's Himalayan work. It's like, come on, get on with it. So that energy is then used for the big alchemical thing, which is difficult. And that is, you're no longer limited by what you think is your personal best. You're starting to do transpersonal best. You decide to do really deep work. So I think that archetypal psychology occurs at this level, if you want to think of a process. And this is what's called meditation. But meditation means going to in-depth reappraisal. And you can't do it if you haven't, according to these traditions, practiced generosity, ethically tuning in, patience, sticking around is interesting, and then you have the energy to do it. How many people have you heard, not you, say, I don't have time to go to depth. You know, I have all these surface things that I have to do. Or, I don't have time to meditate. Do you have time to die? Do you have time to breathe? You know? And this goes very deep. And so going over and over again, we were talking about this, starting with Robert, but you know, ritual in time and place, going beyond time and beyond place, beyond our habits of self-referential, not reverential, referential awareness. So that billions of different possibilities then start arising so that there's this kind of, again, I'm perhaps using the word too often, archetypal pull, a pull toward depth, toward center. And this is what I think Gilman and others call soul making, no longer being terrorized by surface hope and fear. And so I totally forget like why I'm even talking which is maybe an example. You know. So okay, I, this would be classified as depersonalization. I have to be careful and stuff. But
you're basically saying what the difference between imaginal and real smoke is.
Oh yeah. So everything is real and everything is imaginal at the same time. If we have in Healing Fiction, which is a great book. Okay, so how many of you know Hillman's book, Healing Fiction? Okay, you know it's a double entendre, right? Certain fiction heals, but also it's a fiction that you ever get healed. And so he talks about the myth of literalism in like reports and stuff like that. Yeah. You got like 10 more? Mm-hmm. Okay, well, let's take one from the other side of the aisle.
Oh, I had a question on line 6. Where it says...
You're talking about to Heidi or to me?
Oh, to you.
Okay, line 6.
I was just curious about the 10 directions.
Okay, yeah, somebody came up here. So the 10 directions are north, south, east, west. That's 4. The in-between, 8. Zenith and nadir, 10. But it's a trope meaning everywhere. Okay, and sometimes they'll say, I pray that all this is transformed in the 10 directions and 4 times, past, present, future, and timeless.
With timeless, Devin's giving me the signal. That
well,
might
it's 7:30, but I mean, we can, you know, anyone can stay. But
is this a union shop?
I'm
going to get kicked out?
Yeah.
Okay,
no, we're not kicked out.
As soon as you guys like throw tomatoes or... empty out.
Yeah. We're not kicked out, but we want to welcome anyone
okay.
that needs
anybody
to go.
Anybody
like
who wants to
handle.
Go, go.
Yeah.
You're welcome
yeah.
to go and be timeless.
No, only those who want to go should stay. Okay. Or we should divide up into Ginger Rogers and Fred Astaire. And we have extra high heels. You know what I'm talking about?
No, I'm too nice.
Ginger Rogers.
No, don't get into it.
No.
She did all of the dances, but backwards.
Backwards
and
everything.
Okay.
It's totally relevant. yeah, Robert.
My question is for Heidi. The piece that you presented.
Yeah.
I'm curious about. I was like going. Well, wait. Can I call it a ritual because it's from one god to another god? So I'm curious about how. I don't know how much we know about the culture, but how would a person who wanted to work with this story work with it if they wanted to do? Did they take one of the positions? Do you just meditate on that? How does this text work with a practice or with any, and I don't mean big practice, even a little practice or a ritual or anything you wanted to do.
Yeah, well, there would be a big distinction between how I would use this text ritually,
mm-hmm.
which I do use, and how it was thought of ritually at the time. We have no idea how these texts were used ritually at that time. There is a huge amount of other literature that talk about specific rituals, like to get rid of snake bites, to get rid of the evil eye, to free one of a fever, those kinds of rituals, very specific to a specific.
And do those purpose. Rituals have an I in them? So like it's like I do this versus a god and a god?
It depends. They can conjure, they will like might go through a series of gods and say like, I want this god to come in, I want this god to come in, I want this god to come in, and then they'll do these rituals. And
there's still an I.
Yeah, there'll be eyes. Yeah. With or the god is the main speaker. But this, it being within a narrative text, more like a narrative poetic text, the part that I consider the ritual within this text alone is the 4 parts, the salt in the earth, the blood in the dust, poor peace, and still bliss. And the ritual part of that is there's 4 parts of this, and then within each of these, there's 4 different ways you do the ritual. There's an imaginal way, there's a substance way, there's a cultural way, and there's, I guess, an affectual way. And so what I would do, and what I do do is I would, when I say salt in the earth sacrifice, the word salt has four different ways that you offer that as a sacrifice. So it would be salt. You would actually make an offering of salt, whether it's imaginal or physical as a substance. And it also is dead warriors. So all those warriors that had just died, the salt of their bones, the salt of their blood, that gets offered. So anything in your body that has, that you want to get rid of, that you have either annihilated in your own way, in that inner way where you're like, oh, I just killed a bunch of things in my own thoughts, like offer those back as a kind of salt. And then it's also, the word also, these are all meanings of this particular word. The third one is loaves or bread or seeds. So you offer bread or seed to grow the grain. So you offer a kind of, like a substance that will become something new. So you have a dead warrior, you have a new seed, you have salt, physical salt. And then you offer, the overall translation is war. So, and it's not in here, but each of these lines, I could go through them, we don't have the time, but you offer, basically you offer war with all these various substances, imagined or real. And then you go through, and the next line, blood in the dust harmony, is a way of offering love. And so it's a way of, blood is actually a word for red ochre, which is the red clay of the earth that gets crushed up ritually mixed with beer and drunk to subsume, to kind of quell any part of your being that's rising up. So there's, I'm not going to go through it all, and to summarize, there's war, love, peace, and bliss, and there's substances that are aligned with each of those, and so you would offer those substances and then offer each of these acts, cultural acts, and then through that offering, you yourself would have those parts of your being become renewed, like the renewable Anat, and then able to receive a cosmic word. What we don't know what that is, we will never know what that is, but you might have a personal experience. So maybe offering, and I could send you the more specific various substances you could do, but.
I'm just curious, and then do you feel like, is war and love in there because it's trying to create a maximum contrast of polarity to, like, be working with some, I mean, salt is very alchemical, I don't know, is it trying to, like, circumnavigate, like, the polarity of, like, all the way from peace to war and bliss to... and love to the violence.
Definitely, and you see that repeated later with the depths and the deep and the stars, the heaven and the earth, and the another word for earth is, could be translated as the underground or the underworld or the netherworld, or if you're a Christian, hell.
Mm-hmm.
But they have all those contrasts that come in, and so they are trying to pull out these contrasts between the farthest macrocosm,
right,
and the tiniest microcosm, so for sure that contrast is being activated.
Cool.
In order to draw in that contemplative space between the contrasts. Yeah.
Before we take the next question, and before, you know, Cinderella like we end up being something that we imagine to be ordinary, I wonder if you would be willing to spend 3 or 4 minutes to tell folks. We didn't go to Bling or Us. These objects here actually have a direct relevance to the things that Heidi, maybe I did. So can you say something about these rocks and substances and also the pigments and the colors that are here?
Yeah,
is that okay?
Yes,
please. Kind of,
yeah,
because it's,
very
a, brief.
Yeah.
It's kind of cool.
Yeah. So like I said, like she said in the beginning, I'm an artist at heart. I'm not an academic. I'm not a psychologist. But I was drawn to this text through imaginal practices, but specifically to the word I was just mentioning to you, the blood, which is actually a red ochre substance, and then further down, the word of stone. And in my mind, I was really drawn to this text because the power of the cosmic secret being a word of stone meant a lot to me as an artist, because all of our paints, most of our sculptures, stelas, like places that you go for oracular worship, they have, any place that has an aesthetic potency is made of words of stone, literal words of stone. So all of these are are mineral pigments that I have gathered or gone to that I feel are have a sacred relevance, or I was drawn to a place because of their sacredness. And they, you crush these up, and so for some, like lapis lazuli, if you're familiar with alchemy, you have to do a bunch of other processes besides crushing up, like heating and separating and heating again. And once you've crushed them up or done these other ritual processes, they just become sub-pigment for painting and for creating mantras or writing sacred words or writing or, you know, painting your sacred body canvas. And so the fact that this text referenced mineral pigments as a source, as a ritual substance, red ochre in the earth, and just a geeky side notice, he would say the ritual, the four lines of the ritual, the four substances in that, if you put them together, actually is the formula for making oil paint and or water-based paint. So you take this stone, you take a particular oil, you take a particular kind of salt or and or a seed, flax seed is what we make our oil paints out of, and then you have a ritual substance that you can literally aesthetically use to transform the stuff that's bothering you or hurting you into an image or into whatever. So I'm really attracted to the actual word of stone as God's, the speech of God. So for me, the colors of stones are the words of the gods, partially. And just really quick, you were talking about pine cones, or someone was talking about pine cones. This is one of my favorite word of tree, whisper of stone, because this is a pine cone that was fell into a mud from a tsunami, and then it mineralized into a stone over time, and it's this most amazing blue color inside that's the color of lapis, and it was used, it's mostly used in actually Northwest Native American traditions as a shamanic pigment, but it's just like this beautiful, for me, calcification of that cosmic secret being a word of tree and a whisper of stone together, and then I can get this blue. There's a whole bunch of other scientific things about this blue that make it awesome, but I'm not going to tell you guys.
And can you say something about this huge rock here?
This is red ochre. This is a sacred. This is from a sacred site up north in California, and you would grind. This is what you would use to make the ochre substance for the ritual. And then we also, you guys have ochre around. You have the sub-ritual substances on campus. We went for a little walk and. The substance in here, anything that has a kind of red, you can keep your eyes out, a little red covering on the sandstone out here, or if you go up the mountain a little bit, you can just take a little bit, crush it up, spit in it, or add water, or crush up some bread and turn it into oil, and you will have a false blood substance, a ritual substance you can use for offerings or for painting or for eating. It's safe to eat. It actually has a medicinal capacity as well. That's a little side note about those.
Please.
So these rituals, are they considered in both traditions, or generally personally to you two, are they considered redemptive in themselves?
To be what?
Redemptive, or are they to prepare one to regain themselves, like work out bad karma in your spare time.
Also known as this human life, right? Tick tock tick.
You're already being quoted. Yeah.
Well, from the traditions that I know, and I love that word. I'm gonna maybe have to pay you a royalty on it. But I wanna use
redemption.
Which is pretty Christocentric, but I'm going to leverage it to these traditions. But yeah, yeah. My favorite redemptive phrase, I'm a huge fan of gospel music. Okay. Anybody into gospel music here? I don't know. Okay. Okay, here's the best line of full immersion baptism I ever heard. And I double dare you to come up with something better. I went down doubting, and I came up shouting. So, in that spirit, well, it's not like you could be shouting afterwards, but yeah.
Well, redemptive is to remedy. It comes from remedy more. Like I have right now, I have four planets in Gemini. Saturn is a opposing all these planets. I don't believe in astrology, but I find it very useful.
But you play one on TV.
and Saturn is Kronos, it's time. So there's a redemption for that.
Thank you and goodbye.
I'm wearing a watch.
Uh-huh.
That's Kronos. And also, because I'm blowing it Saturn-wise, I have a watch on it. Reminds me.
So I got a question for you. What does redemption mean in the face of the fact of your own mortality? You got to get saved before you end up dead?
No, I'm saved every breath. Because I don't really deserve this breath.
You know that song, Every Breath You Take? That's a stalker song. Goodbye, darlings.
Thank you.
Yeah. So, they're going to the park.
I was just to speak to that a little bit. On your theme of confession, not confession earlier, I will give you a little bit of a confession, which is that I was drawn to this text because I sort of broke my own, I went through a kind of tragic experience that personally, and then this text helped me redeem a sense of beauty that I had felt like I had lost. And so by connecting back to this text through the beauty of the text, through the way that it opened up my heart back to becoming an artist again, or like having a real sense of being connected to that tradition. I think it both was redemptive personally and then opened me up to being able to redeem a tradition that I wanted to be connected to, and also this tradition. So I don't know if that captures, but that's just a little personal.
Yeah.
So I think that's definitely relevant.
And there are traditions that say our redemption is dependent on our open-heartedness with living beings, and that what puts us at risk for not feeling redemptive energy is blocking, separating, and judging. Now, you have to be careful how you use that. So these are traditions that say, and I make a distinction between a broken heart and a broken open heart. And the broken open heart is, I think, consonant with the image of the heart, in the Christian traditions, and how psychologically one can alchemically separate out those two is quite a task, and I think that's also part of soul making. I would say, Devin's been very kind, you've been very kind, and I'm hearing the TikTok tick. If anybody, for like wacky reasons, wants to be in touch with either of us, our overlord and goddess here, Devin, has our emails, and I would be happy if you want to do further connectivity, because it just opens up,
mm-hmm.
And the only downside of this is you guys could have done something here and it's just, center, periphery. And I just hope that something mildly amusing and slightly provocative or transformative might just be a little seed that might sprout before the next big raging forest fire. Okay, so anyway, I want to thank you.